Coming up next on Maine Challenge, Jane Calderwood of Brunswick. Hello, and welcome to Maine Challenge. Our guest today is Jane Calderwood of Brunswick. Jane will go in a little bit to her background, but we know her as the former chief of staff for U.S. Senator Olympia Snowe. Welcome, Jane.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks for being here. I understand that you are have become part of the Lincoln Project, and you are not following closely to the line of the Trumpublican Party. And I wonder if you'd talk a little bit about your journey, maybe some of your employment background, and also the process of getting to where you are today.
Certainly. Well, I was born into a moderate Republican family in Bangor, and I almost got my father in trouble. He was working for Charlie Cregan when he was running for governor, and I sent him off to a Cregan fundraiser with a Longley for governor button, but my mother stopped him before he got in the car, which I was kind of bummed about. He took me
so
down.
That would have been 1974.
Yeah, I'm old. When it was time to register to vote, he took me down to Bangor City Hall to vote, to register. And I don't know if it's because he was afraid our neighbor who worked in the registrar's office was going to convince me to register as a Democrat or not, because he didn't take either my brother or my sister down. I was raised in a moderate Republican family. They voted Republican, they voted Democrat, it just depended on the person. And I graduated from Bangor High. I went to Bates College in Lewiston, got a degree in economics. While I was at Bates, they have a short-term program at the end of the year. And my freshman year, I did an internship with then Congresswoman Olympia Snowe in her Bangor Maine office, my hometown. And then 2 years later, a year later, I went down for a month and worked in the Washington office just to see how the other half lived. It was very different. My first time on a plane, you know, first time in the big city, all that fun stuff. And then when I graduated from college, they had an opening in the Bangor office. So I worked there for about a year and a half, and then they sent me to Washington. And I worked my way up the ranks. I was in legislative assistant. I was a legislative director in the House, and when we started in the Senate, and then I eventually became chief of staff, I think basically because I outlasted everybody.
Your entire career has basically been working for Olympia Snowe.
Well, I spent 20 years with her, and then I went on to be an evil lobbyist for a while. I worked with a firm that represented the American Shipbuilding Association. So I got to work with Bath, and I got to visit the other yards, Pascagoula, our mortal enemy, of course, and San Diego, and worked with people who made all kinds of all the things that go on the military ships. So I had to learn this whole new language and convinced a bunch of engineers that they could not give a 42-page presentation when we had 10 minutes with the admiral who would make decisions on what went on a ship. That was fun. And then I worked for the American Airport, and I was their chief lobbyist. So I worked for the Department of Transportation. I traveled around the country visiting the airports and talking to people and getting them more actively involved. And organizing our press strategy when they didn't, one year they didn't extend funding. And so there like was no money. And trying to convince the world that this was actually a problem for airports, that they didn't have money.
And so skipping to now, how are you employed these days? What do you do for work?
I am a consultant, and I do a lot of, I do writing for different people, and I'm finishing up a project for the George Mitchell Institute on his congressional record.
And what inspired you to decide that, it's going to be easier to answer the question if I say what inspired you to decide that you weren't a Trumper, but I really want to get to Susan Collins too, because you have not endorsed her for re-election.
Donald Trump is not a Republican. In my opinion, he ran for the nomination because he figured he could beat whoever was running. And I think if he thought that was the case on the Democratic side, he would have gone there. I mean, he's no more Republican than my cat, who is a dyed-in-the-wool Democrat.
Your cat would be more of a Republican living with you.
She'd be a better president, let's put it that way. She's tough but fair. He has no concern for people or the rules or the process. He just wants to run it like I guess he ran his businesses. And that's not how the world is supposed to work. And I think the pandemic, unfortunately, and his handling of it has shown us just how mismatched he is in this position. And he's overturned everything. I guess the whole apple cart, I would say. I didn't vote for him the first time, and then I registered to become a Democrat, which I swore I'd never do. But I did, because I just didn't want to be have anything to do with a party that he suddenly decided he owned.
And how did you get to, I don't know, have you endorsed Sarah Gideon or any of the other candidates?
No.
Okay, so how did you get to your position as opposing the reelection of Senator Collins?
Well, I worked with Senator Collins a lot when I was worked for Olympia in the Senate. I admired her for a long time, but she won't stand up to Trump. She won't stand up to the Republican leadership. She certainly isn't, she holds up Margaret Chase Smith as her mentor and her idol, for lack of a better word. And she's certainly not acting like Margaret Chase Smith. And I know she has it in her, which is what frustrates me the most. But to just go along to get along is not what we need. It's not what Maine expects of their representatives. And so I've just, I thought about it for a long time.
Where I would love to go is a question in my mind, and I've been a Democrat for many years, but I was also first involved in Maine politics in that 1974 election. I was a driver for Harry Richardson, who ran in the Republican primary back when there were moderate Republicans. He was one, definitely, and an environmentalist and a friend. And I got to know him, and he wanted to spend time with friends more than he wanted the sycophants that become your clinging staff in the campaign. And so I wound up driving him, and we went all over Aroostook County, all up to St. John Valley, Western Maine, had a great time. And then he lost the primary in June of 74. I didn't mean to start talking about me, but that seems to happen. My question is did Susan Collins, was Olympia Snowe a spirit guide for Susan Collins? Because My sense is a lot of people say Susan Collins has changed. I sort of think she has too. And I'm wondering if it was when Olympia left the Senate that Susan all of a sudden sort of lost her way. Is that a possibility?
Well, I would hope that wasn't the case because, you know, she's a grown woman. She's very smart. She makes her own choices and they didn't always agree on everything.
I know that.
They worked together on a lot of things and they were pretty formidable dynamic duo when they got together, much to the Republican leadership's dismay. Because when those two decided to do something, it was going to happen. I don't know what it was. I mean, some say, you know, the Senate has changed a lot, which it has. There is no middle anymore. I mean, it's not just the Senate, it's the Republican Party, in my opinion. There isn't really a middle anymore. And there used to be a very firm, strong middle. And the leadership of the Senate changed, and Mitch McConnell doesn't believe in actually negotiating anything. It's his way or the highway. And with Trent Lott, and even when Dr. Bill Frist was in charge, doctors should never run political parties, but you know, you could eventually, he was not used to anyone saying no to him, but you could, and if you had enough people with you, you could, you know, you could get what you needed to get done. So I don't know if maybe it's just a, you know, meeting everything coming together and the change in the party and the change in the presidency. Maybe that's all part of it. I'm not sure.
Do you think that there's a reasonable chance that Susan will lose this reelection?
I think this is going to be a really interesting election all across the country. So I think anything's possible. And it'll depend on how people, you know, feel in November and whether the ship has been righted at all. I mean, if we continue the way we are with the coronavirus and the mail being screwed up on purpose and, you know, the economy going nowhere and all that, I think any incumbent, regardless of their party, is facing a pretty daunting task, let alone, you know, all of them have their own issues, other issues to build on top of it. So I think I wouldn't want my boss to be running for re-election this cycle, because I think it's tough for everybody.
Are there Republicans currently in office who are just biting their tongue and biding their time? It seems to me that at the Republican convention this summer, if there was any doubt that this was the party of Trump, it was erased at the convention. And I mean, I've supported Republican positions over the years, but I can't imagine how someone could say, yeah, let's trash the post office. Yeah, let's defund Social Security. Let's lock up children in cages. They'll never grow up and be mad at America. Why not? I just don't get it. I don't understand how reasonable, intelligent people who have been successful enough in their lives to get to high office can go along with what's going on. Any thoughts?
Well, that makes two of us. And, you know, when I keep waiting, and this is just, I guess, me being Pollyanna-ish, I keep waiting for Congress to finally say no. Say, this is ridiculous. This isn't the way the world works, and we're going to fix it. But that's clearly not going to happen. I think the Republican Party, the fact they didn't even bother to come up with a platform, tells me they're just running on Trump, whatever that means.
It's out of fear. It's not determination.
He's one man, and yeah, he, you know, goes after people and makes their life miserable. But how can you defend a president who, what he said about our troops, the big Atlantic article, what he said about our troops? I mean, the men and women who served this country, whether you agree with whatever war they were sent to or whatever, they're amazing patriotic heroes who work hard, their families support them. And, you know, to not go to a cemetery. And I've been lucky enough to be in France and gone to Normandy and stood on Pointe du Hoc, where the Rangers, a very small number of American Rangers, stood off the assault, and been to the cemeteries. And if there's a more sacred place, I have yet to see it. And to not go, I just can't even, I don't know. I have run out of words to describe how I feel about what's going on, because, I mean, I worked in politics for a long time. We had good presidents and bad presidents. We had some presidents who rose to the occasion. Maybe they weren't so great most of the time, but when the stuff hit the fan, you know, they were there. But this guy is just, he's a whole other breed, and I don't understand why people like him. I don't understand why, but they believe in him, because he's destroying our country. I mean, and in a state like Maine, with his whole thing with the post office and having them take out sorting machines and all our seniors in our, you know, in our most rural towns, they depend on the post office. Heck, I depend on the post office. And slowing down the mail so what, we can't vote? I don't know. It's just, it's like somebody wrote a really bad novel and we're living it, but I don't know what the end's going to be.
Yeah, I'm really curious how the Republican Party is going to survive in the post-Trump era. And maybe Trump thinks there never will be one. Maybe Ivanka's going to take over, or Junior. But I just can't imagine why Republicans are sitting still for this. And I'm not happy with the Democrats either, because they just have to be too nice.
Well, I mean, I'm sure that there are a lot of Republicans out there who are just totally fed up with everything. And you can make a lot of noise, but for some reason, he has the Republicans in Congress kowtowed. Like, I've never seen them. I mean, presidents used to lean on people, you know, on certain issues and whatever. And, but it wasn't like some cult that whatever they said you had to do, you did. So someone far smarter than I will figure out if it was the cult thing or what, but it's not the way government's supposed to be. And our elected officials are supposed to answer to us, not the president. And that's not what's happening right now.
I'd like to hear you talk a little bit about the Lincoln Project. It's my hope that the Lincoln Project becomes a gathering place for reasonable Republicans who believe in America. That's my fantasy, I guess, mm-hmm. or my hope. But I'm interested to know how you got involved, what you do currently in the election cycle, and what's going to happen with the Lincoln Project after the election?
I don't know the answer to the last question on what's going to happen after the election. I was reading some articles about what they were up to and who was involved, and I knew some of the names. There were people I looked up to, people I knew, you know, knew their stuff. And so I just signed up online for their newsletter. And then I got a call saying, do you want to join the Lincoln Women? And I think it had to do with, and now we have the Lincoln Women, we have, they have a veterans set, they have, they have a whole bunch, they're building out the coalition in a lot of ways. They're really smart people. I mean, some of them, and one of the reasons I joined was I knew the names and the reputations of some of the people, like Steve Schmidt, who worked with John McCain, who was one of my favorite members, favorite politicians ever, even though I disagreed with them a lot. And Jennifer Horn, who is, you know, from New England, the chair of the New Hampshire Republican Party. And we're just trying to, you know, get the word out, reassure, let people know there are other options and there are ways to, I guess, to fight back or speak out, encourage them to speak out. And like I said, they're now adding, there's now a veterans coalition, and they just added one this week. Like, I can't remember what it was, but there's a Hispanic coalition within the party. And so we're adding voices on the ground, I guess, to help amplify what they're doing.
Well, does this provide any cover for, pardon me for reusing the phrase too often, reasonable Republicans to speak up and to
I would hope their
guns
so.
And stick to their, not that terrible phrase, stick to your gun, I hate that. Stick to their beliefs in the face of what may be a tsunami. But doesn't the Lincoln Project offer cover for that?
Well, I don't see it as offering cover. I seeing it as a place where you can work with reasonable people to try to amplify the message and remind them what the party is supposed to be and not what it is today. And there are just some amazing people who have been involved in presidential campaigns and done all kinds of things who have good advice and know how to get things organized and who can give us some things that we all can do at our, you know, at our own level to try and amplify the message and convince people that, you know, things need to change and they need to change now. And it's just, I was really honored to be asked to join the Lincoln Women. I didn't think an old political hack like me was useful for much, but apparently I still have a few tricks left.
And what are some of the projects that the Lincoln Women are doing?
We are working on a couple of things. My colleagues across the country are doing some of the same things I am in terms of, you know, in their states and congressional districts doing things. We're also trying to get other people involved and remind them about what, you know, what the party should be and what kinds of people, you know.
And what would be a good way for, if there are people watching the show who want to be a part of the Lincoln Project, either Lincoln Women or some of the other paths that Lincoln Project take, what's the best way to get involved?
If you go to lincolnproject.us, you can sign up to get their emails and all, but it'll also ask you to fill out a little form about yourself. And they have, like I said, they're growing the different kinds of coalitions they put together. And they'll keep you updated on, they don't overrun you with email, but they'll let you know if something's happening in your neck of the woods, or if, they'll send you the latest on sort of their latest scoop on some of the polls and stuff, and it gives you information. And they may reach, and I know some people like me, they just reached out to and said, why, you know, can you, you want to help us cause some trouble? And as the late John Lewis would say, I believe that the Lincoln Project is good trouble. So That's why I decided to join.
Does the project? I mean, they've done some really good advertising, in my opinion.
Oh, I think their ads are phenomenal.
Do you feel like it's working from as an insider?
I hope so. It's so hard to tell, you know, sitting here in lovely Brunswick, Maine, and I know what my reaction is to the ads and things, and I know based on some of the articles and some of the emails we get that, you know, it's moving things in some places, but I'm not sitting at the table, you know, with them, so I don't get to see the big picture, you know, the whole thing. But I think the point is they're very good at getting their point across. Yes. That we need to go back to rational, reasonable people who actually.
But there still seems to be 30-40% of people who are fine with everything the way it is and don't want to see changes and seem to think that Democrats or liberal thought is somehow evil. And I don't know those Democrats. They may be misguided. They may be wrong on issues, but they're not evil and they want what's best for America. And I just can't figure out why this view of Democrats are so evil is prevailing.
Well, you know, you can't decide that if someone's a Republican or a Democrat or an independent that you can't put them in a cat, you know, in their little box, because, you know, the few moderate Republicans left, they're a different breed than some of the Southern Republicans, not all of them, but some of them. And to me, I was raised to believe, and having worked in Congress, I believe this even more, it's really about the person. I mean, the party label is nice, but it doesn't really define, it shouldn't define who you are or what you're going to work on. Because I was privileged to work with just amazing members of the House and Senate while working with Olympia, you know, very conservative Republicans, very liberal Democrats, the whole spectrum. And, you know, her thought was always the more the merrier. And if, you know, if you were into it on the issue, even if she disagreed with them on 8 other issues, if they were on that issue, if they were into it, we'd go. And she used to put together the most interesting groups of people.
I remember.
Get things done. She was really, really good at that. And she was also very hard to say no to.
On that note, we have to say time's up, I'm afraid. I've enjoyed our conversation. I really appreciate your sharing your thoughts and being a part of our show. So thank you again, Jane Calderwood from Brunswick, former chief of staff to Senator Olympia Snowe. We appreciate your participation and your involvement in the election. And thank you for being here.
Well, thank you so much for having me.
Show your support for Maine Challenge and LCTV's programming. We're all about community. Please go to lctv.org to make a contribution. Your support makes us stronger together.